a popular musical group. They are playing to 200,000 people in Southern California. But it is not a typical performance. This is a Russian group, and they're performing live via satellite from Moscow. This is the US Festival 83, where the world's greatest rock artists perform for devoted young fans. But this is not a typical rock concert. Its purpose was to focus youthful attention on the possibility that modern technology can create new understanding throughout the world. On Memorial Day weekend, two one-hour live television exchanges took place between a large tent at the US Festival site and the Moscow studios of Gosteleradio, state television of the Soviet Union. Astronauts, eminent leaders, and ordinary people exchanged questions and ideas across the barrier of space. Later in the evening, musicians, including the Soviet group Arsenal and the world-famous Men at Work, performed across the airwaves between San Bernardino, California, and Moscow, USSR. This program is an account of these face-to-face conversations and musical experiences which tried to bridge the gap between two diverse cultures. From a satellite Earth station on the site, the video and audio signals of the exchange were sent to a satellite 22,000 miles above the globe, transmitted to the Soviet Union and back to California. This kind of communication technology shrinks the world by making face-to-face contact almost as easy as a telephone call.
Coming to you from the US Festival 1983 in Southern California. We're very near the site of the 1984 Olympic Games, where the world cultures will meet in 1984. On the screen behind me, you'll see some of our friends over in the Soviet Union and US Festival representative Jim Hickman.
Richard Lukens and I are here in Moscow with our Soviet friends.
And we'd like to say to you,
I'm Vladimir Posner, and what we just yelled means, good morning, America.
Good morning.
Hello and welcome. It's very good that we can be here together, talking face to face, nearly touching each other. So far, our peoples are virtually strangers to one another. We shout at each other. We've heard each other's rhetoric. Slogans about capitalism and communism. We've seen each other through distorted masks of fear and paranoia. And now two great nations stand armed and ready to go to war at each other. And yet, we hardly know each other. We haven't really met. We haven't cherished one another's very human faces. There are those who fear contact, but our technological creativity has made it inevitable. Our media now places us in one global nervous system. We're just face to face or better. Today, what we're going to do is talk to each other person to person. We're going to explore some of the questions that we have Maybe we'll argue a little. We're going to talk and we're going to listen. And above all, we're going to dance to each other's music and be moved by the same rhythms. Vladimir.
Well, Sam, it's a great pleasure to participate in this meeting. I agree that contacts are probably the most important thing in the world today. The time has come when we have to realize that we are not only a biological entity, but there's more to us than just biology. We are one human race, and we have to realize it. To exist as one humanity or not to exist at all. And I think the technology offers us a unique chance today as never before to realize that. And I can think of no greater way of doing it than talking to each other face to face. I would now like to introduce Soviet questions addressed to the United States.
Here's what amazes me. Why is it that Americans find us sort of mysterious, difficult to comprehend as people? What do women over there think about the future? How do they imagine peace? How much do they know about the Soviet Union? What do they think about Soviet-American trade? I'd be interested in finding this out. Are they preparing for the Olympic Games in the same overall way that we did over here in Moscow? Don't they want to live in peace and friendship and lovingness with us the way people are supposed to? What do they want for their children? How do they relax, spend their free time? Hey guys, do you want to live in peace in this world?
I had an opportunity to ask a Soviet student a question. I would like to know if they would be interested in some sort of exchange student situation where they'd be able to come here and have an opportunity to experience what being an American is all about.
So I would want to know more about the status of women and women's multiple roles.
My question would be, what kind of music would you listen to?
Are there any of them in their late 60s or retirement going back to school for further education?
Do you have Atari?
What would he or she foresee as the ultimate use of space?
Are there any popular stars? Are they literary figures? Are they teachers? Who are the popular idols of the people? That's what I'd like to know.
Now I'd like to introduce our panel. On my left is Rusty Schweikart, an astronaut, one of the 123 people who've seen the world from the outside, and now a member of the California Energy Commission. Immediately on my right, Maurice Mitchell, who is the director of the Washington Annenberg School of Communications and was formerly the president of the Encyclopedia Britannica. On his right, Congressman George Brown, a member of the House Committee on Science, Research, and Technology, and for a long time, one who's been interested in and pushing for the peaceful uses of space, of outer space. So this is our panel, and we'll be talking to you. Vladimir, who have you got for us there? Would you introduce us?
On my left is academician Zoya Malkova, who is a leading specialist in the Soviet Union on education. On my right, the Vice President of the USSR Academy of Sciences, academician Yevgeny Velikov, a specialist in a great many areas, in particular nutrition. And finally, on my far right, cosmonaut Vitaly Sebastianov, a friend of Rusty Schweikert's, and I don't think you need more than to say a cosmonaut. That needs no other qualification.
I'm delighted to be part of this program today. It's good to see you again. And I'd like to say hello to everybody in Moscow there, and also throughout the Soviet Union. Good to see you. I'd really like to ask Vitaly, what what his thoughts were when he was out there floating around in space, because he was out there once too, many years ago.
I saw, looked in my own diary just before coming here. What I wrote was, here I am looking at the Earth and looking at the deserts in Asia, the bright picture of the bright desert of Africa, the civilized parts of Europe, the seas, the oceans around Brazil, around Tahiti. I looked at Canada. Everywhere I saw the human trace of civilization, trace of technology, cities, roads, ports, and the rest. But this was not the main thing. Suddenly I realized that life itself is the main thing, the fact that there is life on Earth, something which there is no trace of in space. This feeling of leaving life for the deadness of outer space is something which really attaches us to the Earth.
It's once in a while, in particular circumstances, a very good idea to have time to think and to let what you're experiencing happen. On my space flight, I was outside the spacecraft and I had a chance to really look at the Earth and say, what is it that I'm looking at and how did I get here and what does this mean, not just to me, but to all of life. And I think the message that came through to me is something which is really universal. That is, we all live on one planet, a very small and a very beautiful planet. We're all dependent upon the same continents, the same oceans, the beautiful blue atmosphere that supports all of life. And one of the things that we have to do is to understand that through the recognition that we're all together on this one beautiful planet, we've got to learn to take care of it and to take care of one another better than we have in the past. I think we have to look at the past as a lesson, not as a habit. We've got to move forward.
We have a question from someone who is from the future or who is going to decide our future.
I'm from Leningrad, and I want to ask, I see a lot of students here, and I'm wondering if there are any children in this audience.
Here we have. Let's see if we have one who'd like to ask a question.
My name's Crystal Tau. In what grade do they learn how to speak the English language?
Somebody answer that for us?
I'm in the fourth grade. I'm in the sixth grade. I get about an 80 or 90 average, and I study just the normal things everybody else does.
Academician Zoya Malkova, can you tell us how the telecommunications and the revolution has been affecting the Russian classroom and how it might affect it at best? How will it change education?
Human being is the great wonder of nature. He possesses unlimited, colossal capacities, creative forces, and scientists think that for the time being, or only about 20%, or perhaps 25% of the human creative force in every individual is being actually used. The fact that we are here talking to you today and looking at one another, asking one another questions, this is the best possible way of educating youth in the spirit of mutual understanding. And in that respect, electronic technology and telecommunications obviously has an enormous role to play.
Academician Malkova and I would agree, as all educators would, that what we want for our children in this world is the best opportunity to live in happiness, to understand their environment, to fight the great enemies of both of our society's disease and poverty and famine and fear. And if we can get that by using these new technologies in this country, we're going to use all of the ones that seem to fit. We now know that our great libraries can be opened up for thousands and maybe millions of more users by using new technology and new communications. We know that the computer and the teaching machines have great significance for us. We're going to turn our country into a classroom if we can, and we see you beginning to do the same thing.
I'm a teacher of history, and if my colleagues would like to know how you study the most important thing, namely how to love humanity and to have esteem for peace. How is this done in the United States? Technology is one thing, but the live word of the teacher is more important than technology, and I wonder if the teacher is going to be that kind of a person.
Chancellor Mitchell, would you like to take a crack at that?
History teaches us what happens to people who try to build power through hate and fear and intimidation. And a good history teacher should be able to demonstrate that people who try to live in freedom and in dignity and to live with each other in brotherhood always in the end triumph.
Here we go. My name is Masha. I'm in the fifth grade and I live in Moscow. I would like to ask how in the United States they like the Russian language. Does anybody study it?
Anybody answer this?
Я изучаю русский язык, я только что вернулся из Москвы. Я учился в институте русского языка имени
Пушкина. И
мы только что закончили наши уроки. Между прочим, я бы хотел узнать от подруги там, Мелани, как идут занятия сейчас.
I'd like to ask my friends who are listening to me in this institute how they're coming along with their examinations.
We haven't had our exams yet. They start next week, but I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Thank
you. I work in the main library of USSR, the Lenin Library in Moscow, and I'd like to tell you, my dear American friends, that we know a lot about American books and have a lot of them. The question I have to you is whether you read books of Russian or Soviet authors, and do you read them in Russian or in translations?
Who would like to answer that? Who reads Russian authors? Anybody?
My name is Don Gourneau. I'm an actor. I don't speak Russian, but I have studied a lot of Chekhov, and he's very famous here in America, and we do a lot of Chekhov plays.
Congressman George Brown, this is happening in your congressional district. You are on the subcommittee, I believe, communications. You can see the impact of what's happening right now, and we'd like to have your impression, what you think about this.
Well, I'm convinced that new technologies of the sort we're demonstrating here must be used for confidence building between our two countries. All of the negotiations in the world over arms reductions, for example, will not succeed unless we begin to trust and communicate with each other. So I think this example illustrates how we can build goodwill, and I'd like to see it extended on a permanent basis. I'd like to see our two academies, the Russian Academy and the United States Academy, sponsor a proposal to dedicate a channel to continuous video conferencing of this sort between the scientific communities of our two countries. We do this in a limited way. We cooperate at the International Institute for Advanced Systems Analysis in Vienna. We could do this on a much broader basis involving much more of our scientific community, and then it could spread from the scientific community to other communities. I'd like to ask if you and the academicians who are on your panel don't think that we might begin something like this. Well, I think it's, Sam, you want to take that?
Do politicians dare talk directly to each other? Could they stand it?
I would like to say that today we're not only talking about the fact that we can talk with one another, we're actually doing it. And this shows that our conversation, we conquered a very terrible enemy, and at the same time, another enemy arose, which, who unfortunately is still here with us. This is nuclear weaponry. Sometimes it seems to us that these are muscles. Actually, they aren't muscles. This is really a cancer, and we have to perform an operation as quickly as possible to liberate ourselves from this cancer. In order to have the get more force, more energy, we have to go through this operation.
I'd like to know, my name's Danny, by the way, I'd like to know what your favorite sports are over there. Ours is supposed to be baseball. I like football.
I
think that the best sport is basketball. But we could make a proposal to you, in as much as the finals of the Olympics, it will obviously involve the Soviet Union and the United States basketball teams. I have a proposal, which is, let your audience cheer for the American, for the Soviet team, and the Soviet audience will cheer for the American team. We'll see who wins.
My name is Richard Phillips, and I'd like to ask about the music scene. Is there a lot of rock and roll in the Soviet Union? And if there is, what are the most popular groups over there?
As concerns the groups,
we like jazz and rock, but rock and roll is what everybody in the Soviet Union likes best, is rock and roll, even though they all know jazz.
Well, if we have time, then cosmonaut, our cosmonaut would like to ask you a question. Cosmonaut Sebastian.
I'd like
to ask a question to Rusty Schwaker. I want to see you on the screen, Rusty. I can't see you.
Hey, turn on the camera.
There you go.
I haven't seen you for a long time, after all.
What?
Okay, now I can see you. Rusty. This is a wonderful direct bridge. Bridge of friendship. And I professionally take this as an, some way of carrying on an internal conversation on the spaceship Earth. All we have to show are the wires, which we can't show here now. But when you can imagine there's a great many wires involved. How do you feel about our future? Are we going to die by the year 2000 or in the year 2000? What do you think about it?
Well, I don't know. Vitaly, every time you and I get together, we seem to have very late evenings with a great deal of lubrication, and we might die by the year 2000. But I certainly hope that humanity continues on, and I think with the kind of communication that we're dealing with today, the chance for understanding around the planet will ensure a continuation of life for thousands of generations. At least that's my fervent hope, and I know you and I are working very hard to see that that occurs.
Sam, I think time has run out on us, so we'd like to say goodbye until 12 hours from now, when we will dance to each other's music. So from everybody, goodbye.
We'll see you all tonight. See you tonight with some music. Bye.
As the day continued, rock fans gathered to hear the music and explore new technologies for communication. Around the transmission tent, technicians and producers were hard at work preparing for the evening connection, as were their counterparts in the distant Moscow studio. This intense activity went unnoticed by most US Festival participants who preferred to dance. And the young people in Moscow clearly felt the same. Gosteleradio had invited university students to dance through the night while waiting for the second exchange. At 7 a.m. Moscow time, 8 p.m. in California, the live performance appeared on the giant video screens.
Live from Moscow, Arsenal! Give him a hand, give him that cheer!
We'll be right back.
people like that was yelling out things against the Russians and stuff, and a little bit of negative attitudes. But once the music started, the musicians were so hot that you know, everyone had a positive attitude and they loved it. When it was finished, there was a really big response.
They were great. They were great.
The Russians come over here and rock out with us.
Didn't look like it was from Russia or any place else. It was just like another group.
Satellite paths reversed as the internationally renowned group Men at Work performed on the stage in California and across the airwaves to Moscow.
People who come into this contact through via music were so emotionally excited that afterwards, when they came out, they were almost different people. Their outlooks had changed due to this emotional kind of sublimation, if you wish, that had occurred with them.
The US Festival tries to put together high technology, education, and entertainment into one package. We've used high technology and entertainment to educate all the people here and the people of the Soviet Union in both studios, that both countries share common goals and common ideas. And the press doesn't always allow us to show that, and the politicians don't always allow us to know that. But as near as I can tell, we were very much all concerned about the same things.
We will not cease to exist. We will continue to be on this earth. And the most important thing to me today, perhaps, was the fact that technology, which to us is always something negative, which creates bombs and weapons and whatnot, I saw it today acting as something that could indeed bring us together and save us.
I've worked in the Russian field for a long time, being of Russian background and taught Russian at university, and I feel that this is a new wave of interest. I know that the Soviets are tremendously interested in Americans and always have been. And I think this is going to help expedite a lot more communication, because there's a natural curiosity between these two very large and energetic nations. And we have to, they're open to exploration, and I think we are too.
First of all, I think it is a very big emotional experience for me to be the witness of this connection. And you see the reaction of people on both sides of the auditorium. Mm-hmm. And this reaction is very positive, I think.
As the evening progressed, American musicians Joe Chirino and Joel Nelson entertained audiences on both sides of the globe.
The quiet winds just drew me, something warm went through me, and I feel I'm missing something, not knowing you. First you seemed so shy, and by the way it caught my eye, the way the corners of your mouth turn up when you smile. All I'm asking is a chance to get to know you. Just a quiet moment that we can share. Just a chance to see if this feeling between you and I can really be. Yeah. Tell me what you honestly feel, and the truth is what makes you so real. I'm trying to open up to you right now. And I'm amazed at how you hold yourself, even graceful poise at everyday things, and the aura around you says completely one. All I'm asking is a chance to get to know you. Just a quiet moment that we can share.
you. We're going to throw it back your way, Moscow. Take it away, Moscow.
We just want to pay a very brief tribute to the roots of Russian music with this special offering from Gosteleradio and this musical group.
National jam session live via satellite. We'll be right back.
Moscow. That was great. Let's hear it from Moscow out there. All right. And Arsenal. All right. Send you this song in peace and brotherhood. Here we go.
1, 2, 3, 4.
You can walk, you can run, but you're all getting there at the same time when the days are done. You can slip and I can fall, but it's laid down and break down the walls. We're all in this together. Look around us. We're all in this together. Make it just a little bit better. I said we're all in this together. Look around us. It's over to. It's understood. Your people, my people, living in brotherhood. We both want the same thing. Well, let's lift our hearts together in peace and sing. We're all in this together. Look around. I said we're all in this. Make it just a little bit better. We're all in this together, and there's only one world. Baby, let's sing.
Good morning, America!
bigger and better every time.